we touch on a lot of different topics on all these different channels, all mostly based on the past and what happened in our past, what happened to the past civilization, why weren't we told about it, and is the past going to repeat itself, and when? So many different angles and clues, and we could consider Tartaria. Tartaria shown on so many different maps from the past, and always leaving us to consider, were these respected map makers such as Ortelius and Mercator simply madmen, along with countless others, depicting this nation or empire or simply people of Tartaria? And whether one is to believe that this people ruled all throughout this realm, or just select to the regions of Central Asia, moving west, north, and east, the idea that we were never taught of these people, and that they seem to have been erased from our history, is enough reason to say that these people and this part of the puzzle matters. Who were these people? How did they live? And why is this knowledge being kept from us? Now, I'm sure by now many of you have seen the CIA document talking about this exact subject, the erasing of Tartaria in history. And not actually done by the CIA, but the CIA simply having commentary on the subject in a memo that I believe was now declassified, and many question the authenticity of this document, but nonetheless, very interesting. And what about the reset? Does the reset really matter? And what is the reset? The reset is an idea that we have clues of past and much more magnificent civilizations than our own existing as little as 200 to 400 years ago, based on the architecture and layouts of our cities and forts, which in past times were called bastion forts and what we call star forts, existing all throughout this realm. Things that we can't replicate today, and really not being hidden at all, just given ridiculous stories on how they were created, and in modern times being repurposed for many different things, one being the pedestal for our Statue of Liberty, and in other instances being backfilled with dirt and turned into golf courses. But back to the reset, does the reset matter? And if you're interested in survival, I suppose it does. And if you're interested in simple history, then it does as well. To me, it is clear there is a reset, which seems to be every 400 years, and it seems to involve water and fire, oftentimes the fire being a byproduct of what seems to be a plasma electrical discharge raging through our realm, causing canyons and melting cities overnight. And in other cases, we see the results of massive flooding. And not only flooding that came from oceans in a horizontal direction, but waters that came from beneath, pushing up and displacing the land and causing new and varied elevations. In many cases, causing what we call mud flood to seemingly bury the lower levels of buildings. in some cases, completely burying cities entirely. And we can see examples of this found everywhere. And this leads right into mud flood. The mud flood is a mystery to us. Many different theories coming from all angles. And again, this could be the result of water, or it could be the result of this plasma discharge, this superheated event that renders matter and formerly buildings into what now looks like mud. And we see this everywhere, especially in the North American Southwest. But in many cases, we do see mud flood in major cities with no sign of any heat damage. And when we look at these cataclysms with mud flood and plasma discharges pertaining to resets, the big question, once one begins to wrap one's head around this notion, is how do these resets occur? Are these a product of man or non-humanoid? Or is this more of a natural cycle? And I tend to believe that it is a cycle, again, every 400 years. And I have some very exciting research to share with you on that subject, but it deserves its own video. And this reminding me of a larger season, a grand cycle. Many cultures sharing these cycles, calendars and artifacts left behind long after the people that made them disappeared. And it is clear that there's different resets. Again, the Native Americans tell us there have been five. And this very last reset that seems to be 200 to 400 years ago, as I've mentioned in past videos, does not seem to be or have been as violent as prior resets. Prior resets turning structures, and some of the most massive structures, into unrecognizable, what we call mountain. And yet when we look at this past reset, we see the most beautiful architecture in the world. The same architecture used most often for government, capital buildings, courthouses, post offices, and so many other municipalities. But not limited. The architecture from this past civilization and this past reset remains intact, built of the finest quality, built in a far superior fashion than anything we build today. And the buildings remain, and they are still so new looking that our people had the gall to write silly stories about them, and how our primitive horse and carriage people built these structures with a very small, unskilled population so recently, and all the people are gone. Then here we've been trying to figure out what happened in ancient times, and yet now we begin to understand. Beyond 200 years, we know very little. Very little about the history of our existence. And here we contemplate the past and what happened to the past people in which we've inherited all of their buildings and cities and infrastructure. And the next question is simply, where did we come from? And perhaps that was a mouthful. I guess I'll leave it at that for today. I hope you enjoyed, and do have a blessed day. Please like, comment, and subscribe. And here for a quick little bonus feature, I just wanted to share this shiprock featured in my last video. And while investigating a little further as to whether or not this ridge line down here may be a wall, I found this image. And here, a nice little close-up. Not the best picture, but clearly what appears to be blockwork in ruins. And now we're told that this is the result of volcanism. And upon examining this wall a little closer, we don't see anything that looks like the result of a volcano.
I've mentioned before that I've always had this feeling when I'm in old buildings. It's not until recently that I've begun to express and understand what I felt. But at that time, I felt it too. I thought, what is this? This is not a college. Everything about it was strange. Even the idea of paying such an exuberant amount of money to learn photography, for example. But then I was in this castle. And what the hell was I doing in this castle? Why did this make any sense? And I walked out of there, but never forgot how strange the place was. And when I began doing this research, I became very excited and remembered this Westminster College. So we'll get back to the postcards, but let's look at this college for a moment. Here we are at Westminster College, Utah. This college was founded in 1875 in Salt Lake City as a prep school. At the time, it was called the Sheldon Jackson College, named in honor of its primary benefactor and minister, Sheldon Jackson. In 1902, the name was changed to Westminster College. Originally located downtown, the college moved to its present campus on 27 acres in the Sugar House neighborhood in 1911, where it's still located today. And so this is the place where I would have walked in naively, and I didn't even realize it was 27 acres. And just across the street from this place is the Sugar House Park. And when we say park, of course, alarm bells begin to go off. And what was in this Sugar House Park at one point, before being demolished in 1950, was the state prison, the state castle prison. So one castle, founded in the late 1800s, this prison stood until 1950 in its castle-like glory, and then was demolished. And yet across the street, another castle, this one that we're looking at, the Westminster Castle College, complete with millions of bricks, sandstone, and who knows what else. And mind you, I don't want to say it was built in 1875, because here even they tell us the truth. It was founded in 1875 as a collegiate institute. 1875, the Mormons arrived in the 1860s in a very primitive fashion. Horse, wagon, mules, oxen, roughing it across the West, many dying. And it's impressive enough that we have the beautiful state prison in the Sugar House Park, as we can see here. But within 10 years, they just threw this college up. Not even a Mormon college. Why must everything be a castle? Why must all the schools be castles? The prisons be castles? Armories? Insane asylums? And really, when you start to look at it from a big picture perspective, everything was castles. Just down the street, we have the Salt Lake City Temple, which is a grand castle surrounded by smaller works of wonder. The Salt Lake City and County building opposing the temple, maybe four blocks away, is also a castle, perhaps even more beautiful. Just a different style, just as this is a different style. And this is upon the inception of this, what we are told is a virgin city. And I'm telling you, they've begun omitting their little construction bit. They used to give us a little attempt or explanation of the construction, which was my favorite. It was like the comic section in the newspaper. But here I wanted to play Where Are We? It's been a while. Where could we be? A very similar architectural style. We have bicycles, bustling with bicycles. Perhaps this is a bank. These men seem very confident in their place in time. And this is in Japan. The Yokohama Bank. Next specimen, Where Are We? Antiquitech in the background, horse and buggy, some trolleys, and a very massive building. Excessively massive for these people who look like they're just barely getting by. Just my take and feel. Surely we could have cut this building in half. The doorway is at least 3 times, possibly 4 times the size of this man. And what function could such a building serve? But not the point. Where are we? Where in the world are we? How would we know? This building could be anywhere, with its glorious Corinthian columns. This is Argentina. In French, argent is money. And I see the word argent in Argentina. And somebody had money. And this one will be fun. A lot of hustle and bustle. Doorways again, 3 times the size of the people. Super elaborate and excessive. As if someone just had a blank check and told the builder to spare nothing. Where could we be in this early time period? Just rolling out with the first few models of automobile, it looks like, but still having some horse and wagon alongside. This is in a country that gave us the Buena Vista Social Club, one of my favorite bands, a great band to listen to on a Sunday. And this is Cuba. We've looked at star forts in Cuba and a coastline just riddled with absolutely advanced architecture. Even more advanced than this. But again, this could be anywhere. And how about now? This looks like some glorious kind of coliseum or stadium. Circular amphitheater. Plus, we see a couple guys over here in the corner looking very serious. And I don't know about this street. Looking very altered. The blurriness meeting sharpness. So abruptly. And I think this baby is in ruins. If we look at this staircase, kind of seems broken and crumbled. Of course they would tell us it was under construction still. But I think it looks like it's in ruin. And where are we? What nation do you guys belong to? These two men over here standing on a pyramid-shaped pile. I'm not sure. These natives are from Pakistan. This building, I think resembling one of the stadiums in New York, and resembling a lot of modern stadiums. We see this style repeated. And here we are in old Pakistan. And this one I'm gonna have to be careful with and not give it away too soon. Just amazing. And again, looking old. This looks so old, it looks unused. And the tech, and the metalwork. This is so expensive. All of this would be so expensive to do today. That's why we use cheap wood and sheetrock and just face things with stone and half brick facing. It's so damn expensive, and this stuff is quality materials, right down to the core. And I don't know what's going on. There's all kinds of little apparatus sticking out here. Perhaps these are our flagpoles. Let's scroll down a little and give you a little peek. We see people struggling back here with water buckets on each side of the shoulder. And we see a rickshaw. A bunch of rickshaws Here are the builders. Here are the builders. Hello, builders. How did you build all this? And these people can't answer us because they were all wiped out in Vietnam. Here is a theater in old Vietnam. And just to remind you, the true purpose of war. How completely clear could anything be from this image? Again, nothing special about this architecture seen everywhere. It's when it's put in context, it's when some perspective is shown on this snapshot in time. This architecture and these people. I mean, these people don't even have horses. We're just pulling things around like we just invented the wheel. Here, this poor mule is just being pushed to the limit, pulling some sort of drum, some liquids, maybe just water. And here we go. These people, just inheritors of this region, completely out of place. Vietnam. And here a beautiful, beautiful castle, looking like it's been abandoned for at least 50 years. And yet somebody seems to have excavated much dirt, just a mud pit all around it, but cleaned up. And look at this elaboracy. Again, someone with a blank check, plus some. A good tip thrown on top. What? And just looking abandoned. Always a couple guys in suits in the corner. Perhaps this one is a woman. Just hanging out. Of course, we would be told this is post-construction, and these men are just waiting for the landscapers to arrive. Where could this be? This could be anywhere, and this could be anything. This beauty is in Africa. South Africa. Exactly what comes to mind when one thinks of Africa. This one's too difficult. If I show you too much, it's going to give it away. And this baby is just crumbling. Look how chunks are just missing up here. It looks like it's really been stripped. Just stripped, just hit with hammers and ornamentation just busted off. And look up here. Just be careful not to show you that flag. I don't know if it's me or... But nonetheless, let me show you another one. Okay, I have to be careful again. Where are we? Same place. I think this is that building we were just looking at. Oh, you can kind of see the flag. And I've shown this in a past video before. Just a massive chunk of building here. And a clock, and it just goes on and on. Where is this? Ta-da! This is China. Or as I said in a past video, China. Unbelievable. And real quick, just another Chinese ruin right here. Simply the ruins. Some sort of cathedral. Okay. Where could this be? This is too innocent. Let's go a little hardcore. Here we go. Amazing. The Public Trust Office. And look at that. Tech antenna. And the thing just looks like shit, actually. Look here. It's like the facade is crumbling off, revealing the brick. Here, I think the facade is barely holding on. And here, too, on the columns, you can see how sections have either been painted, just touched up, maybe chunks were falling off onto the people. And here we do have automobiles, very early models, and some old tech lighting. Where could we possibly be? This is actually one of my favorite examples, besides San Francisco and Salt Lake City being so young as states and then just looking like all this stuff found everywhere. This one is also very anomalous. Doesn't make any sense. This is New Zealand. And New Zealand. Horse and buggy, early time period, sending prisoners off, we're told, to a remote area as a sentence. And then this, boom, this, suddenly so old and weathered and as glorious as any part of the realm. I was always told that they were very resourceful in New Zealand because they didn't have much supply and goods and they were forced to be handy. And I had even seen that with my own eyes. They were very resourceful and a handy people. But when I see things like this, that doesn't make any sense. Clearly, there was enough of everything back then to do what everybody in the world was doing. New Zealand. And let's do one more. I love this one. And this really held up well. And yet we see she's been through hell. The discoloration, the reds, the dark browns, the staining. And yet it's made of such excellent concrete that all this detail has held up. Unbelievable. Just glorious. And where could we be? We could be anywhere. This place is out in the desert, in an absolute wasteland. Formerly the site of a glorious civilization, we are told. The land was covered in palm trees. And currently this place is known for some of the largest pyramids in the world. This is Egypt. Not what you think about when you think about Egypt. And it's very fun to play Where Are We? Because it forces you to consider what you've been taught to think about places. And here's another old Egypt pick. And again, old Egypt. Very old. But not that old. And I could play this game forever. But for the sake of time, I think I'll leave it there. This last one is from Canada. And so once again, here we are. Looking at similar style buildings, not only all over the world, but similar within one city. Salt Lake City is one of the best examples because it's one of the newest cities along with San Francisco. And both Salt Lake and San Francisco are chocked full of these same types of buildings, these old world wonders. And I think there's no stopping this awakening, especially with the internet. I think this understanding will continue to spread and grow for years to come. And there's an expression that says, change happens one death at a time. And it's a very patient approach. Very Taoist and accepting. One just waits for change. One death at a time. And eventually, those that pushed the old paradigm are gone. And the ones that are left have no strength left. No fuel, no ammo. They have been exposed, and they just let it go. But it's difficult to say. If people continue to get their information from the wrong sources, A, they will never even see things like this. And B, they will just believe whatever they are told. They'll never be taught to be critical thinkers. That is not what the system encourages. But I think the controllers have gotten so greedy in these last few years that this will ultimately be their demise. So greedy, squeezing every last bit of liberty and money out of the system. And surely they should have known that such things don't work. The parasite can't kill the host, or even make the host sick. That is not beneficial to either party in the long run. But I think all the lies that have been propagated for the last 150 years have been done in a very tight and controlled way with a long-term plan, a 100-year plan. And this 100-year plan involves every nation in the realm. And we saw this in the last 2 years. How quickly did every nation jump in the boat together, massaging each other. All these nations that supposedly don't agree on anything just jumped in this boat without hesitation. And I've talked about other examples where they just jump in the boat, suddenly begin marinating as one. And that would be the Antarctic Treaty. Over 50 nations on board in complete unison with this treaty that nobody should be allowed to go to the southern regions of our realm. And here, very similar. But my point is, I don't think they have a 100-year plan now. I think this is the end, and we have the third and fourth generation removed inheritors of the original controllers and creators of this plan. And now it's just done, and there's no vision, and they're sloppy, and perhaps stupider than we even know. And I do think they are sloppy. Again, their stories are comedy to many of us, repeating the same themes. And if one was just to scratch the surface of history, a little here, a little there, one may not notice these similarities of false narratives. Unbelievable, this one. These photos are from stolen history. And my condolences to the family and loved ones of the kind man who passed recently. Very, very strange passing. Very upsetting. So I think I'll leave it there today. Maybe I'll pop back in for a bonus. I was just going to do 10 minutes here. And I was just going to look at these pictures to stimulate my thoughts. Some kind of backdrop. And I'm very tempted. But I think we'll leave it there. Thank you so much for joining me. And do have a blessed day. Please like, comment. Oh, I forgot, I don't say that anymore. I love you all. God bless. Next. Scratch that.
Welcome. I wanted to show these three maps today. One is from 1595. This one here is from 1606. Let's see, this one is the 1595, and this one is also 1606. So I want to focus on a few different points. First of all, an interesting point here is we have Greenland with no ice. And that's pretty interesting to have charted mountains and rivers, and even right here we can see some towns. One town, two towns. That's how they mark their towns, as you can see in Iceland here, which is spelled island at the time. Many towns and totally ice free. And again, this would be 1606. And yeah, you get an idea of what the towns look like, what the forests look like. And what I wanted to focus on was this little island here called, it appears as if it's called Freeland here, but at times it's called Friesland. Or like Friesland, maybe. And you can see how many towns actually there are in Friesland. I mean, this is not some imaginary town. Now, if we jump over here, we also see Friesland with many towns. Iceland, still many towns. Greenland, free of ice. And if we jump over to this map from 1606, we can see it here, Friesland, and here it has the S, and this map shows up really crisp. So here we have Greenland, Groenland, Iceland, again spelled with I-S-land. And here it is again. Now, if we jump over to this map, a modern day map, which of course is, a little exaggerated, but there is no sign whatsoever of Friesland. I mean, like, none, not even close. And I'm just going to focus on three maps today, but hundreds can verify this. Now, the next thing I wanted to focus on was these towns in Asia, or what we call Asia in modern times. Now, Asia would be up here, and over here we would have Europe, and Sweden, and Finland. Right here we have Russia, and in these times Russia was called Rus. And this is shortly after the name was Tartaria. So already we see Tartaria replaced with Rus. But what I was going to focus on was these parts of Asia, which we would now call Mongolia. And just to have a reference, let's see what it looks like on this map. Make it a little smaller. So yeah, we're going to be talking about this area. Upper Siberia. No, not Mongolia. I was totally wrong. Sorry. So yeah, this is just Siberia. And very remote. I mean, you know, Moscow is over here by Europe. And most of the towns are in this lower area. And I mean, when you're talking, this is like equivalent to, you know, our Alaska, but much bigger and much more. And so, yeah, let's have a look on the old map now of this region. And we see many towns amongst these mountains. Here and here, a bigger one that appears to be a castle. Smaller, but still substantial, and even something here. I'm not sure what that is. It's coming in a little grainy for me. And here we have Tartar Wild. So these are the Tartar cities. Now let's jump over to the very same same maker. By the way, this is Mercator. Again, this map of Mercator is very, very similar. Also of 1595, but what we can see, sorry, I was having an issue. Now what we can see is in this northern part of Asia, we have one and two towns in this region where we had about half a dozen before. We still see this strange thing. I don't know if it's a figure of a man or a statue. But now he has no color. And yeah, much less activity. Much less activity as we saw in this earlier version. You see, Friesland, Mercator always felt it was important to put Friesland in his maps. I mean, you know, you're pretty limited here. He has four spots, and Friesland is zoomed in, whereas typically it is here. You can see it's not even very small. It's a fair-sized island. It's about half of Iceland. So yeah, again, here it is now in this later version of a 1595 map. And really, again, this is all about an 11-year change. From 1595 to 1606. And here, we now see nothing. We see ghosts, ghostly shells of towns but not significant, not like we see in these maps when we look at Friesland or in this one. Very significant town activity. It's very clear, and he puts this in the corner of his map, and then we see this. And there may be one here, or maybe, but really they've become ghosts. And so next, I want to focus on this very most obvious part of this map of 1595, which is this. I mean, this is absolutely amazing. This North Polar region. And again, Mercator gave us this map. I mean, maybe not this exact version, but when we started using this map, this is Mercator who gave us this. And he's a very respected map maker. And we can't assume that he was a fool and put this island here with great detail. And here in the center is Rupus Nigra, is what he calls it. And this is the North Pole. This is a magnetic black rock, as it's been described in the text that we do have. I mean, there's a lot written about this, and obviously there's map making, and we can see this in hundreds, if not thousands, of maps. Even in this map, we see it. We see it in this version. And this mapmaker's name was Paulus Marula. And this island appears to be gone now. Just a little tip shows up on maps these days, or Google Earth, this Nova Zemla. Just a little piece of it, and it even has that name still. But definitely this North Pole is gone. And yet, up to a certain date, we always had this. And here, if you look to the left, we have Greenland. And Greenland almost connects in most maps. And then we would have Iceland right here. And in this map, we cannot see Friesland. And it would be off right about here. So, this North Pole. Here we see we have Pygmies, a region inhabited by Pygmies. Now this, I think, is written in Latin. And these rivers, and as it's been written, and again, I don't have the writings here, but I've heard there's a lot of information. And these rivers were said to flow inward. I think one or two flowed outward and one flowed inward, but it was as if it was a drain, and sailors would get pulled in, and it was very difficult to get out. And really fascinating. And only 11 years later, we now see a portion of this pygmy portion missing. It's missing, it's been faded out, and these islands have changed right here, which pretty much, you know, you might be able to... Oh, regardless, here's the Nova Zemla that I was talking about. And yeah, these islands have completely changed. They've been redrawn and pretty much some things are just gone. Some parts of it are completely gone. And so the next thing that I wanted to focus on was something on this map, actually. And I'd like to do another video more on the Americas, North America. But I found this really fascinating, how right by where Chicago might be, we have Shilaga, and we have a town. Again, we see a town on the river, and in all maps, this region here is always Shilaga. And to me, it always seemed like it was very much like Chicago. But here again, you can see the North Pole in this map as well. And Iceland is called Island. And we can see it here, Iceland and Greenland. And here, I believe we can see Friesland. So Friesland is still here. And even another island that's pretty much close to the east coast of Canada. And, you know, I encourage you to pull these videos up and study them for yourselves. I mean, they're really, really fascinating. And especially these areas where, you know, if you look on Google now, you know, I mean, what are you going to get when you look at Greenland? Here's what you're going to get. And I don't really think this, we're seeing what we're seeing. I think this is just kind of imposed over. I mean, this doesn't look, and I've played around with Antarctica, and you'll see pure ice, and then if you zoom in and allow it to load a little bit, and it's doing it a little bit here, things will load. And I've actually pulled up lakes and green mountains in Antarctica, and I've done the same thing with the deserts in Nevada, where it looks like just a bleak, white kind of tan desert, and then you zoom in, and there's all sorts of amazing things. But yeah, I find it fascinating that, you know, these older maps completely show all the rivers, and I mean, we get a better picture of what's really going on from these older maps than we do from these Google images, that's for sure. I mean, here we can see Iceland. Now, let's note on this map how this little town right here, called Saxa, next to Skålbolden, the beautiful castle of Skålbolden, has three what look like towers. Three skyscrapers. And if we jump over to this version, down here, we again see these three skyscrapers. Two mid-size and one larger than the others, and this Skålbolden castle. Now, I find it really interesting that if we look at where the ice is, it appears to me as if the ice is sitting right on top of this area. And once again, let's have a look. Right where that would be. Boom. But again, giant chunks of missing. I mean, when we looked at those older maps, there were towns all over Iceland, and it was completely ice-free. And that's not what we see now, and we certainly don't see our little island of Friesland, which was half the size of Iceland in thousands of maps going back as far back as map-making goes. And I find it really fascinating. And of course, our North Polar region is completely missing. And I don't know. I mean, I think, what are we really looking at here? I mean, what has Google given us? But I find it interesting that there is no imagery here. But yet, if you go over here, there's a little trick that I've seen. I saw it on YouTube, and you can go to this little island here, pretty much in between Alaska and that Siberian region. You just zoom into this little island here, and all of a sudden, it's like, I don't know if someone was leaving us this as a little clue, but this thing goes on, and I think it goes right to the North Pole, and I followed it, and I don't know if I'll do too much of it right now, and you can go back and do this yourself. But it appears, you know, I mean, this lion looks more realistic than this blue. Now it turns into two lions. And yeah, I don't know if that's an error or if it was a little gift. But yes, I mean, I think that, you know, and I don't know how much we can really zoom in. But yeah, there's activity here. There's action, as there has been shown in all of these older maps. So it's pretty fun, actually. I'd encourage you to go take a little trip down this line here, and it's very much full of more truth than I think what we see here. So that's it for today. Thanks so much for watching. Please like, subscribe, and comment. Have a blessed day.